That is going to be lit and the reading done by Jim and Helen Dodson.
First we lit with the candle of hope, or prophecy, reminding us of the hope he brought to our hopeless estate. The hope of salvation and redemption. One of the hallmarks of the Christmas story is when the angels appear to the shepherds and proclaim peace on earth. This week we light the candle of peace. Jesus brought about peace in the most unexpected ways when he arrived. The Jews, particularly the zealots, wanted a rebellion. They wanted their Savior to overturn the oppressive rule of the Romans and bring about the peace in a violent way.
But Jesus had something else in mind. Jesus brings us peace in a number of ways. First, he gives us peace with God. Because of his work on the cross, we have a chance to receive salvation and to be indwelled by the Holy Spirit. This grants us an inner peace. Not only do we have the peace that comes from our assurance of salvation, but we also have the peace of mind knowing God will heal this broken world and will come again. We have peace with others. We put aside our differences because we see other people and our own purpose from God's perspective. We have the same purpose, to let others know about the peace of Christ. The Hebrew word for peace, shalom, goes far beyond not fighting with others or peace as we know it. Shalom is, in essence, how things are meant to be, a slice of heaven on earth. The peace of God allows us to look at others through heaven's eyes and help guide the world to see God's here and not yet here kingdom. Peace from God, biblical peace, allows us to trust in God's promises through restful, tranquil faith despite the dark, scary world around us.
Good morning. Welcome to Fair Bluff Baptist Church, an imperfect people serving a perfect Savior. We want to look here in our bulletins this morning and take notice to the items. If you're here, you know the service has moved to 11, but please spread the word. We have moved back our Sunday school to 10 and worship service at 11. We're currently have choir practice at 9 before that. In preparation for our Christmas music. Also Sunday nights, 6 p.m. and for our meal in the CLC and 7 for our Bible study. Our Lottie Moon Christmas offering, through last week it was $270, so keep that in mind. Our goal is $1,000, and we have a Baptist Men's VA Christmas project where we're taking donations for the VA hospital. So we're collecting those through December 15th. You could get those in. And remember to pick up your Home Life and Mature Living magazines. They're in. Other items, we want to remember our individuals that are on our prayer list. And we have a Christmas events program or project going on. Is Julia here? Can you update us on that, please?
Sure. Yep. Wednesday, this coming Wednesday, is the last day to donate anything for Happy Birthday Jesus. What we're going to do on Saturday, when the Fairbrook Visitor Center is open, getting ready for Santa Claus and for the parade that evening, we're going to have a table, and it's going to talk about just throwing a party. We're going to give away these boxes that have a cake mix and frosting, candles, balloons, some extras in there, just for families to take home and celebrate Happy Birthday Jesus with their families. And so, kind of a chance to reach out to our community, share about the birth of Jesus in that way. So if you'd like to donate monetarily, you can put it in offering, or you can buy some cake mixes, frosting, balloons, or candles and put them out here right by the door on the side. So thank you.
Thank you, Julia. I know my wife's excited about that project. She's been working with that. Also, Sonia, would you update us on the poinsettia project?
People said this morning they forgot to fill theirs out. There's some forms.
Thank you, Sonia. Any other announcements this morning?
I have something. We want to start by thanking, on behalf of West Columbus, our boys are on the road traveling basketball a lot right now because we haven't got our bleachers in. I want to thank Jeff and Sherman for feeding the teams on Tuesday. The church fed the teams on Thursday, and Piney Forest fed them on Friday. That helps out a lot when kids are leaving school and they're not getting home till 11, 12 at night on the bus and getting home. I also want to tell you, you know, if a lot of people are trying to stay close by for the pandemic. We've got a lot of things going on, like in competitions as far as basketball. The FFA has been competing a lot. Our cheer, they competed yesterday, did well. And our band was in the parade and JROTC. So we've got a lot of things that students are doing. I know I was counting here a while ago. We got Catherine, Xander, and Kellen, and James Craven that are participating in all this stuff. So if y'all like, we appreciate if y'all come out and support them. Tuesday night, we have a Christmas concert in auditorium. And I know that Xander's in it. Xander's anybody else in here? Who else we got participating? That's it. He'll be singing, have quite a few more with our band and our, I think it's just chorus and art will be displayed. So y'all come out Tuesday night at 7 o'clock, I believe, which we'll appreciate it.
Thanks, Jeff. Any others?
Our cheerleaders, they competed in Raleigh yesterday. They are state champions.
Oh, great. Thank you. We're definitely proud of our local high school and everything, all our clubs. Any others? Thanks. If not, I'll turn it over to Pastor Darren.
We are going to enjoy a prelude by Ms. Hilda here shortly, but you can, during this time, go ahead and turn to page number 89 in your hymnal and say a little prayer that God will be with us during this service this morning. Number 89. This morning in your hymnals, we're going to sing together, "O Come All Ye Faithful," as we stand.
Glory to God, oh, glory in the
When I came to Fair Bluff, that's a year ago now, my first Sunday was on a Hanging of the Green Sunday, and I have never in my entire ministry led a Hanging of the Green Sunday. I didn't grow up celebrating the Hanging of the Greens. I know of church that did, of churches that did, but so this is still something new to me. But the more I become acquainted with it, and more I learn about it, the more I like it, because it helps us to place a beginning along with the lighting of the Advent candles on the Christmas season, and it points us toward the real meaning of Christmas. And so this morning, that is exactly what we're doing. We are decking the halls of Fair Bluff Baptist Church, and that's something that I'm thankful that we can do a year later. It's been a trying year for many of us. If you're anything like me and you've experienced loss, holiday season isn't an easy time for anyone, but it's something that we can look toward with rejoicing, knowing that we have hope in Jesus Christ, that He is our hope, and we have an assured future and eternity with Him, and our loved ones are with Him, and not only that, but we look forward to His coming again and establishing His reign upon the earth and doing away with all the ugliness that exists in our world today. Amen? So I would like for you to look toward your bulletins and the responsive reading. This morning, our church will begin to wear its Christmas apparel. The preparation for this beautiful season is not something which we shall have done for us or performed by others.
This is something which we shall do ourselves, each individual and family sharing in the furnishings of this house appropriately for the celebration of Christmas,
the coming of Christ. Would you bow your heads with me in prayer? Father, as we begin this service of worship, Lord, I pray that You would help us to take this opportunity to turn our hearts toward heaven, to, Father, lay aside every thought, every care, every inhibition, Father, every attitude that would stand in the way of our worship. And, Father, help us to remember the first coming of Christ and to look forward toward the second coming. Father, help us to look forward to eternity with You, knowing that this life is only a flash in the pan. But, Father, because of Jesus Christ, we have a hope and a future that is secure with You. Father, I pray today that if there's one in this place that stands in danger of an eternity in a devil's hell, Father, that You would help them to see their sin and their need of a Savior. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. At this time, our ushers are going to come, and we are going to collect the offering from any who would like to give, and at the conclusion of that, we will do our prayer requests and praises. Amen. know many of you have got different prayer requests and also praises. Any prayer requests that you'd like to make mention of this morning? Uh-huh. Sure.
Also, little Daniel is sick right now. He's just, I don't know, he's running a fever and he feels really kind of peewee, so that's tough. So pray for Daniel and Savannah, especially. And the last thing is, Elizabeth and Brad, they're doing great. Elizabeth had a little hiccup this week. She just barely failed her sugar test. So now she's got to check her blood sugars and stuff. And so, we're excited that everything can be controlled in that way, but she's bummed about that
because
when you're pregnant, you should be able to eat
what
you want.
So. We will definitely be praying for Elizabeth and baby and Bradley as he hangs on and does nothing but watches. I was reminded with both of our boys, all I did was sit back and watch. I didn't grow no baby, so. Yes, sir. Scotty Williams. I've got him down here, and that is from Mr. Billy. Pray for Scotty Williams.
And Mr. Marshall Friend from the Super Bowl community.
Uh-huh. We will definitely be praying for him this morning. Ms. Donna?
Two things. One, Pete Williamson from Chadron.
Pete?
Stroke the other day. And I don't know if he's in Point Blue, if he's got moved to Wilmington. And I really don't know his condition. I don't think it's bad. That's all I know about him. And our other son, Justin, been having some abdominal pains that he's trying to find out what's going on.
So we will remember him. Any others? I saw other hands raised. Oh.
I just wanted to give, I guess, a praise report for my cousin Marilyn Stetson, John Jr., and Phil Lombard. He is now able to sit up on his own. He's off the bench. He's able to sit up on his own. He's actually trying to smile.
Wow.
After day 43, I think, in the hospital. But after day 39, he's able to sit up on his head.
And they were close to making some hard to sit. My goodness. Praise the Lord for that. I'm glad for them. Shusha.
Mama has an appointment with a cardiologist. Don't know when you know Wednesday. She had a pacemaker put in last month.
Mm-hmm.
So, we just had to be praying for that.
We will definitely be praying. I've been seeing Miss Sarah outside doing her rounds every once in a while. Yeah. But we'll be praying for her. She'll have that fire back in her real soon. Anybody else? I want to say thank you again to all of you that have helped us with moving. A lot of these guys have made some spur-of-the-moment trips to either auger some holes for a massive dog lot that I dreaded, or just moving some of our junk. I told somebody the other day, it looks like an episode of Hoarders just blasted through our front door and landed wherever it would. So we're getting there. We're getting there slowly but surely. And we appreciate all of y'all and your patience, your prayers, and just appreciate it very much.
Sunday night trying to get
Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Well, I tell you what. Affix it. Well, that's a good idea. Well, it always takes a smart woman to help a bunch of ignorant men get the job done. So, good job, Karen. Yeah. Any others? And we're thankful for all that Sonia and Carolyn have done in getting the sanctuary ready. I mean, there's a lot of, and Woody, I'm telling you right now, Woody's been here too. But they need, every once in a while, somebody needs a strong back and a weak mind, and a man's just the guy to do the thing. But they have worked hard up here getting everything ready with the poinsettias and everything else. So thankful for that. Anybody else got something? All right. Well, this morning we're going to have a word of prayer, and we're going to continue with Hark the Herald Angels Sing. I think it's one of my favorite Christmas songs. But if you would bow with me in a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, you have heard the prayer requests that have been made mention of this morning. Father, some emergencies that are unfolding as we speak, some of these situations long term where we've seen you work and do great things. And Father, we thank you for all that you've accomplished. Father, we pray for these families, the friends, the many things, Father, that need a touch from you. And we pray that every heart and mind would be reminded to return the praise and glory to you and you alone. For every good and perfect thing comes from above. Father, we give you our praise for the people and the planning, Father, the effort that has been put into so much of our Christmas here at Fairbluff Baptist Church. And Father, we pray that in the future they would become even better. Father, we pray for your continued supply for the needs that we find ourselves facing every day, no matter how great or how small. And Lord, we ask that you would continue to draw us together in the bonds of Christian love. Help us to be passionate about the mission of Jesus Christ carried out in our community and in around the world. And Father, remind us every day that what happens in the kingdom is not about us, it's about you, and it's about bringing others into your kingdom. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. As I said, we're going to sing Hark the Herald Angels Sing, and that is number 88, hymn number 88, as we stand. Seated. The second chapter of the book of Luke, we all know that Luke, the gospel written by Luke, the physician, the disciple of Jesus, he records what is probably the most read and recognizable story of Christmas. And the Bible says, "It came to pass in those days that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered or taxed." This census first took place while Quirinius was governing Syria. So all went to be registered, everyone to his own city. Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house of the lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed wife, who was with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For there is born unto you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be the sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger." And suddenly, there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." So it was when the angels had gone away from them into heaven that the shepherds said to one another, "Let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us." And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they had seen him, they made widely known the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all those who heard it marveled at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all that they had heard and seen, as it was told them. We're going to sing Chris Tomlin's version of Noel, and I think most of you will recognize this song. It's one that I certainly enjoy. And stand with us this morning. We're doing a lot of singing this morning, and you can go away from here not having to listen to very little preaching. So you'll have a good Sunday in that respect, I guess. But I want you to stand together, those who are physically able, and sing this song together that you'll see on the screen here.
Love incarnate, love divine. Love incarnate, love divine. Star and angel gave the sign, bow to babe on bended knee, the Savior of humanity. Unto us a child is born, he shall reign.
At this time, we're going to have the placement of our poinsettias, and many of you have purchased these poinsettias that will be a part of our church for years to come, and will be here as a reminder of God's faithfulness and your faithfulness to His purpose. But I want to share with you something that Dr. Lundy once shared at the church many years ago. The velvety poinsettia has become the most popular Christmas flower and often decorates many churches during the Advent season. Contrary to general belief, the red, white, or pink leaves are not the blossom. Rather, the small yellow flowers in the center of the cluster are the blossoms. The star-shaped formation of the leaves is a reminder of the star which shone over Bethlehem's stable. And I would add to that the red leaves of the living poinsettia plant are the mature leaves. They're leaves that after a certain period of time will no longer be a part of the plant, but they will, in essence, pass away. And it's a reminder to us that Jesus came to die. He came to lay His life down, a ransom for sinners. And this season is all about the amazing story of what God has done for us in sending His only begotten Son to pay the price for our sins. So if you have taken part in the poinsettia remembrances, I'd ask that you come forward this morning, and you can take some direction from some of these ladies that know how these things are supposed to be done, and place them this morning to decorate our church for Advent, or for Christmas season.
Thank you.
This time I want you to, and you can remain seated for this, but we're going to listen to the words of this song. We're all familiar with the hymn, which I love, called I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day. This is based on a poem by Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. And he says, I heard the bells on Christmas Day, their old familiar carols play, and wild and sweet the words repeat of peace on earth, goodwill to men. And that is the message of Christmas, that the Prince of Peace came into a world that was devoid of it and is devoid of it and becomes our peace. Peace with God, and peace with one another, and peace with ourselves. So listen to the words of this song and the challenge that it issues to believers.
Thank you.
been thinking about that subject of peace this week, and you know, we just a little while ago went through a series on the book of Ephesians, and one of the things that Paul drives home is the fact that everything is spiritual. There is a spiritual battle that's happening in our world today. And if you want to see a spiritual battle, set an alarm. Set aside time and set an alarm for Bible study and see what Satan will do to stand in the way of your spending time with God. Everything has a spiritual element, and Satan's greatest ambition, if he can't keep us from being saved by Jesus, he wants to make us useless to the kingdom of Jesus. And apathy is at an all-time high. Pessimism, all of these things in our world today. And we look at these things and we think, well, this is a symptom of a pandemic, or this is a symptom of an economic situation. And we could go on and on with the reasons behind what we're seeing out there today. But the basis, the bottom line behind every one of these troubles that we face is the reality that we live in a spiritually broken, sinful world. And we live in a world that does everything it can to pull us away from the purpose and the promise of Jesus Christ. And as we look to the scripture during the Christmas season, and I hope truly that we do remember the real meaning behind Christmas. I will never forget what my cousin Jonathan did with his kids 1 year for Christmas. You know, Christmas has become such a commercialized thing. And Jonathan's always been big on teaching his kids real, valuable, spiritual life lessons. And one thing that they did 1 year when the kids were small but old enough to understand, he said, "You're not going to get any Christmas presents this year. Instead, what we're going to do is give something to someone else. We're going to give presents to others this Christmas." And he wanted them to understand the significance behind what Christ had done for us in giving and without the expectation of ever receiving anything back. God gives his only begotten Son. He knows that we cannot repay him. There is no recompense for what God has done for us. You and I, if eternity were laid out before us, could not do enough to repay what God has done for us through Jesus Christ. But that is the freedom of his giving, and it's the freedom of the giving that you and I should also express in the world around us. I want to share with you from 2 Corinthians chapter 4. You don't have to turn there. I'm going to be very short. In fact, I'm going to read this passage of Scripture, and I'll probably be finished. But listen to what Paul says to the church at Corinth. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. He says, "Therefore, since we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we do not lose heart. But we have renounced the hidden things of shame, not walking in craftiness or handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God." He says, you, the Corinthian church, you, Fair Bluff Baptist Church, are called to be a manifestation of the truth of God before every man and woman that you meet in the world. He says, "We have been saved not to walk in craftiness, not to walk in deceitfulness, but to walk in truth." He says, "commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. But even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. Those minds the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. For we do not preach ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your bondservants for Jesus' sake." Listen to what he says. He says that there are those in the world, he says, if we veil our gospel, we are veiling the gospel to those whose minds have been darkened by the power of this world, by the prince of the power of the air, he says, by the evil one. And he says the world does everything it can do to obscure the light of Christ. He says, "lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them." Listen with open ears at what popular culture says about the faith of Jesus Christ and doesn't say about all the other stuff floating around in our world today. You don't know why that is? Well, it's not just because Christians are Christians. It's because there is a spiritual battle that is happening. It's a spiritual battle that causes the world to reject the truth of God and to embrace everything that is falsehood. There's a whole lot of acceptance for everything but Jesus. What God has to say, and Paul tells us that we're called to live truthfully, not allowing the light of Christ in our lives to be obscured. He says, "For we do not preach ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your bondservants for Jesus' sake. For it is God who commanded light to shine out of darkness, who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ." Philippians calls him, or tells us in Philippians chapter 2, tells us that every knee will someday bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Hebrews calls him the brightness of God's glory, the express image of his person. 1 John tells us that Jesus is the Word, the Logos, the very essence, the very expression of who God is, and that he came into the world, was rejected by the world, and the light shined in the darkness, but the darkness comprehended it not. The Bible says that because he came in that very same chapter of John's Gospel, chapter 1, that you and I have received grace for grace. Grace is a reason for us to remember Christmas. It's a reason for us to remember the meaning of Christmas every day. We celebrate the hanging of the greens to celebrate the coming of a Savior. One who has come and will come again. What do we do for a party? Well, oftentimes we decorate. For a birthday party, we decorate. We mark the significance of what's happening. Isaiah tells us that the glory of Lebanon shall come to you, the fir tree, the pine tree, and the box together to beautify the place of my sanctuary. Evergreen trees. The symbol of life. They're called evergreen trees because they bear their needles. They remain green throughout the year. It's a symbol of life. Eternal life through Jesus Christ coming into our lives. The laurel, the bay, symbolize victory and triumph. You see these in Roman symbology. Mistletoe, regarded as a symbol of peace. Oftentimes, when we walk under a mistletoe, we're supposed to kiss whoever we end up under that doorway with, right? But a kiss is a symbol of peace. It's a symbol of peace. When we look at the holly, mistletoe, a symbol of peace, Christians also see in the leaves of and the berries of the holly, symbols of the crown of thorns and the sacrifice that Jesus came to make. He grew to manhood. He made that sacrifice on Calvary. The wreath itself, a symbol, a never-ending circle, another symbol of life. We hang the greens to reflect our joy as we recall the first coming of the Lord. This is a special time in the year. It's something I think my favorite two seasons are Thanksgiving and Christmas, not just because of the food, okay, but because it's a time that we turn our hearts toward thankfulness to God, the mission of Jesus Christ, and then Easter, just around the corner, we celebrate the complete mission that he fulfilled. During this time of the hanging of the greens, many of you have already been told how this is going to happen. The baskets are placed here up front, and you can come collect those and pick a window and decorate it, hang the garland, complete the work of decorating the house of God for the Christmas season. You can come on forward. While we sing this next song and the bells toll, we are going to have our ushers to come. They're going to pass out the candles, and we'll do that in just a second. But as we sing, they're going to come pass out a candle to you. Make sure your family gets one, and stand with me as we sing hymn number 118, What Child Is This? What child is this who lay to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping? Angels greet with anthems sweet while shepherds watch are keeping. This is Christ the King whom shepherds guard. Number 3. So bring him incense, gold and myrrh, come peasant king to own him.
The King of peace, salvation, breathe
the
loving hearts
enthroned
him.
This is Christ the King. Light is a symbol of the Christian faith that is so old that Jesus himself told his disciples, not once but many times, you are the light of the world. And every Christian during this time, we light the candle of our own lives. He tells us that we are the light of the world. A city that's set on a hill cannot be hidden, neither should our light be placed under a bushel. Candles were not commonly used by first century Christians. For the long days of the Mediterranean region stretched to embrace part of the night. It was when persecution drove the worshipers to the catacombs that they found it necessary to use lamps and candles. After Christians were allowed to worship openly, the custom of using candles in worship became well established. At Christmas, the use of candles reflect our mood of quiet tenderness and flaming joy. The church services of Christmas are frequently held in a candlelit church where the mystery of the softly gleaming light reminds the worshiper of that first Christmas. As we light candles and we see the light spread, as we share the light one with another, the light moves across the sanctuary just as the light should move across the world through the efforts of the church. By our efforts, we should see the light of Christ magnified, not dimmed. And Christmas is a time when you and I rededicate ourselves and remember that He came as a light in darkness, and you and I also are to be lights in darkness. We're going to close out our service this morning with one of my grandpa's favorite hymns, Joy to the World. So if you would look in your hymnal, page number 87, and as we sing, we will end on this candlelit note, singing Joy to the World, the Lord is come. Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare Him room, and heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing. He to the world the Savior reigns. Let men their songs employ, while fields and floods, rocks, hills, and plains repeat the sounding joy. Repeat the sounding joy. Repeat, repeat the sounding joy. Verse 4. He rules the world with truth and grace, and makes the nations prove the glories of his righteousness, and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders, wonders of his love. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
All right, let's pray together as we extinguish our candles this morning. Father, let us not go away from here and allow the light of Jesus Christ to be extinguished in our lives. But Father, help us to hold high the name of Jesus. Father, help us to be a light in a dark world, pointing people to the gospel, pointing people to the only way of salvation. Father, we love you and we thank you for hope. We thank you that this is a season that is filled with hope. And thank you, Lord, that we can gather together in this place today as a church family and welcome this season. Father, help us as we go away from here today. Join us together. Bring those who are not able to be with us today back into our number at the next appointed hour. We'll give you praise for all that you do. In Jesus' name, amen.